Random House Audio presents Our Lady of the Forest by David Guterson. Read for you by Blair Brown. One, Annunciation, November 10th to November 13th, 1999. The girl's errand in the forest that day was to gather chanterelle mushrooms in a bucket to sell in town at dusk. According to her own account, and the accounts of others in the North Fork campground, who would later be questioned by the diocesan committee, by Father Collins of St. Joseph's of North Fork, by the bishop's representative, and by reporters covering the purported apparitions, including tabloid journalists who treated the story like a visitation by Martians or the birth of a two-headed infant. The girl left her camp before 8 o'clock and walked alone into the woods. She wore a sweatshirt with its hood drawn tight. She didn't speak to others of her intentions. Setting out with no direction in mind, she crossed a maple bottom and a copse of alders, traversed a creek on a rotten log, then climbed a ridge into deep rainforest and began searching for mushrooms in earnest. As she went, the girl ate potato chips and knelt beside rivulets to drink. She swallowed the antihistamine that kept her allergies at bay. Other than looking for mushrooms, she listened for the lonely music of birds and, she confessed this later to Father Collins, stopped twice to masturbate. It was a still day with no rain or fog and no wind stirring branches in the trees, the kind of stillness that stops time, or seems to, for a hiker. The girl paused often to consider it and to acknowledge her aloneness. She prayed the rosary on her knees. It was Wednesday, November 10th, so she said the glorious mysteries, before following an elk trail into country she hadn't visited or perhaps didn't recall. A flat grown up with Douglas firs, choked by blowdowns and vine maple draped with witch's hair. Here she lay in a bed of moss and was seized by a dream that she lay in moss while a shape, a form, a bird of prey, a luminous man, bore down on her from above. Rising, she found chanterelles buried in the interstices of liverworts and in the shadows of windfalls. She cut them low, brushed them clean, and set them carefully in her bucket. For a long time, she picked steadily, moving farther into the woods, pleased because it was a rainless day on which she was finding enough mushrooms to justify being there. They drew her on like a spell. At noon, she read from her pocket catechism, then prayed, "Give us this day our daily bread," before crossing herself and eating more potato chips and a package of 2 chocolate donuts. Resting, she heard the note of a thrush, but muted, faint, and distant. Sunlight now filtered through the trees on an angle through the highest branches, and she sought out a broad, strong shaft of it, stippled with boiling dust and litterfall, and lay on her back in its luminous warmth, her face turned toward heaven. Again she slept, and again she dreamed, this time of a furtive woman in the trees, lit in darkness as though by a spotlight, who exhorted her to rise from the ground and continue her search for chanterelles. The girl got up and traveled on. She was lost now in an incidental way, and the 2 strange dreams disturbed her. Feeling a vague desire again, she put her hand between her legs, aimlessly, still walking. A cold or flu had hold of her, she thought. Her allergies and asthma seemed heightened, too. Her period had started. The newspapers reported that her name was Anne Holmes, after her maternal grandmother, who died from sepsis and pneumonia a week before Anne was born. Anne and her mother, 15 at Anne's birth, had lived with Anne's grandfather, a long-haul trucker, a man with complicated gambling debts, in a series of rental homes. The newspapers, though, did not uncover that her mother's boyfriend, a methamphetamine addict, had raped Anne opportunistically beginning when she was 14. Afterward, he would lie beside her with an expression of antic, contorted suffering, etching his hairless, long face. Sometimes he cried or apologized, but more often he threatened to kill her. When Anne was 15, she took a driver's education class, which she missed only once, on a Friday afternoon, in order to have an abortion. 8 months later, she expelled her second fetus into the toilet at a mini-mart on the heels of a bout with nausea. On her 16th birthday, she bought a two-door car, dented or crumpled in more than one panel, for $350, earned foraging for truffles and chanterelles. The next morning, she drove away. Anne was diminutive, sparrow-boned, and when she covered her head with her sweatshirt hood, it was easy to mistake her for a boy of 12, fair-skinned and dreamy. She often wheezed asthmatically, sneezed feebly, blew her nose, and coughed against her fist or palm. On most mornings, her jeans were wet with the rain or dew transferred from the fronds of ferns, and her hands looked pink and raw. She smelled of wood smoke, leaves, and rank clothes, and had lived for a month in the North Fork campground in a canvas tent by the river. Others living there told reporters that she'd rigged up a plastic tarp with twine and often sat under it against a log, reading by firelight. Most described her as silent and subdued, though not unpleasant or inspiring unease, not threatening in her estrangement. Those who saw her in the woods that fall, other mushroom gatherers mostly, but also several elk and deer hunters, and once a Stinson Company timber cruiser, were struck by her inconsequence and by the wariness of her eyes in shadow underneath the drawn hood. A mushroom picker named Carolyn Greer, who lived in a van in the North Fork campground, claimed that on an evening in mid-October, she had eaten dinner with Anne Holmes, sharing soup, bread, and canned peaches, and speaking with her of present matters, but never of themselves, their histories. Anne had not had much to say. Mostly, she stirred her soup pot, listened, and stared at the flames of the fire. She did indicate a concern for her car, whose transmission no longer allowed her to shift gears or to travel anywhere. The car's battery had petered out, and its windshield and windows appeared permanently clouded with an opaque, viscous vapor. It sat beside her canvas tent, gathering fallen cedar needles, both seats loaded with plastic bags, paper sacks, and cardboard boxes stuffed with her belongings. Carolyn didn't tell the bishop's representative that while the soup was simmering, they got high together. Primarily, it was nobody's business. Furthermore, it implicated her, too. Carolyn indulged in pot regularly. It surprised her that Anne, after a few tokes, did not become effusive and talkative like most stoned people around a campfire. Instead, she became even more reserved, more hermetic and taciturn. Her face disappeared inside the hood of her sweatshirt. She spoke when spoken to, terse but polite, and poked incessantly at the wood coals. Her only subject was her dead car. Stranded, Anne had resorted to the county bus, which stopped at a convenience store a half mile from the campground, and dropped her in front of the market time in North Fork for 85 cents one way. She paid, the county driver reported, with exact change, sometimes using pennies, and replied in kind when he greeted her. Once he commented on the mushrooms in her bucket, on their number, size, and golden hue, and she gave him some, loosely wrapped in newspaper she found at the back of the bus. On the highway, she slept with her head against the window. Frequently, she read from a paperback book he eventually discerned was a catechism. When she got off in town, she said thank you or goodbye, her hood still drawn around her face. A half dozen times, she accepted a ride from a mushroom and brush picker named Stephen Mossberger, who wore a dense beard, Coke bottle glasses, and a wool cap pulled low on his temples. Seeing her carrying her bucket of chanterelles and walking the road one afternoon, Mossberger rolled down the window of his pickup, explained that he lived in the campground as she did, that he picked mushrooms just like her, then asked if she wanted a lift. Anne refused him without affront. No thanks, she said. I'm okay. The next time he saw her, in late October, he pulled over at dusk in a modest rain, and she accepted without hesitating. When he leaned across to push ajar the door, she got in, smelling of wet clothes and mushrooms, set the bucket of chanterelles on her lap, and said, It's a little wet out. Where are you from? Mossberger asked. Down in Oregon, not far from the coast. What's your name? She gave him her first. He told her his full name. He put his hand out to shake hers, and she slipped her hand into his. He wanted to believe afterward that this moment was freighted with spiritual meaning, that in taking her hand, he felt the hand of God, and he described it that way to the diocesan committee and to the bishop's representative. A hand that was more than other hands, he said, connecting him with something deeper than his own life. But, in fact, he understood privately, What he felt was probably little more than the small thrill a man gets from shaking hands with a woman. In North Fork, Anne sold her mushrooms to Bob Frame, a mechanic who worked on logging equipment and ran his mushroom business on the side. Garrulous and jocular most of the time, he spoke with an instinctive brevity and disdain to the first journalist who intrigued.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.